This presentation will explore emotional intelligence and coping skills for student athletes.
Objective 3, to apply coping and emotional intelligence intervention to a sample of volunteers and evaluate the efficacy of these interventions. A nice quote related to emotional intelligence: no one can change your feelings, you make your own feelings by what you tell yourself. Feelings are thinking skills, which puts the link between your thoughts and your feelings together very nicely about how we can then do interventions to improve emotional control. We'll look at some of the principles. A is for activating event, and any situation that links to an emotional reaction is called an activating event, and it can be anything. But if you think back, there will be a whole to two when you've become emotional. Those emotions occur in situations, and those situations are, in this case, the activating event. The B is the beliefs about the event, and people don't become emotional without a set of beliefs, and that reactions to situation. If an argument with your partner, an argument with your coach, it's typically based on a belief about what the coach was thinking, or what the situation was all about, or what you brought to the situation. And you can question these beliefs, and these beliefs are something that are not fixed in stone, and therefore, as part of the interventions which would work, which will evolve, is some of these beliefs about the event, if they can be changed, then what follows from that is the emotional responses to those situations may not occur in the way that you have conditioned them in. In other words, your beliefs about the event have conditioned emotional responses which you may not want to be occurring. So people become angry based on a set of beliefs, and if they challenge those beliefs, then they may be able to alter the extent to which they become intensely emotional. We'll look through an example of how that came about. So we'll take anger. Anger, because it is an emotional state we can all relate to in terms of when we see it in others and when we experience it in ourselves. It's an intense emotional state. It's sometimes seen as very good, and beliefs that anger get the anger out. But it's an emotional state which occurs in a very conscious way. So if we think about the last time we were angry, what caused us to be angry? What was the, in other words, what the situation was, and when we became angry? When did we notice we were angry? And then why we were angry? What were your beliefs about the event as to why you became angry? And I mean, people, road rage being a classic for anger. People get angry in the car, and the beliefs about why they become angry is that people, learners, for example, drive on the road at 5 o'clock simply to wind you up, which is a belief that you get angry because the learner's there deliberately to slow you down from getting from A to B. If you changed your view on why the learner was on the road, you may not get so angry when you see a learner. Which then relates to the relationship between the self-talk you give to yourself and the subsequent feelings of anger. So look at anger management as a skill, and for those people who have difficulty with their anger, the notion that it can be changeable is a very useful thing to start and engage with. I'm going to look at it in through 5 steps. One is tuning into what is anger's all about, and some of the early symptoms of anger. And anger tends to be an emotional hijack, where you're feeling relatively calm one moment, and then the next moment you're not, and there's some massive physiological changes that occur with that. Second, looking to calm down when we're starting to feel anger, using self-talk to change our beliefs about the situation. Thinking of some of our options, and then fairly key to this approach to emotion regulation, but also key to almost all intervention strategies, there has to be some sort of reward so that you are conditioning yourself and conditioning the thoughts so that you anticipate situations where you may become an emotion which you want to avoid experiencing, and you've conditioned a new way of interpreting that situation. So when do you become angry, and when are the symptoms of anger first being noticed? And there will be physical symptoms that accompany anger, and they may well occur before you really blow into a full rage. And just working through those and identifying where they are, the earlier you can identify the emotional hijack, the better. And some of those symptoms, I'm sure most people have experienced when they're about to get angry or during a full-blown rage of anger. But there's nothing new in those sets of feelings. Some of the points of calming down: potentially harmful myth, get the anger out. Well, the notion that getting the anger out might be beneficial to you may not be very beneficial to those around you, and it's thinking of what the most appropriate way to deal with any situation is at any one time. But explosive outbursts rarely are functional in social situations, and even in sport, where we have proposed that anger might be quite effective, it's usually very, very low levels of anger and not the sort of anger which is noticeable in terms of explosive outbursts. Typically, anger is associated with losing control and making more hostile and more aggressive. So certainly the idea is to get anger under control, to be able to be in control and to be able to manage those sets of feelings. And there's again a series of commonly used techniques that people can use, typically addressing the physical symptoms, but which also seek to get the mind or thoughts under control. Key point: people and things do not actually push your anger. It's you, your interpretation of situations, your beliefs about situations which have allowed you to react, and those are subjective. Remember, and you choose to react or choose to respond to those frustrations. And that's a choice that you make, and it's being aware that you have made a choice, and allowing the anger to escalate can actually lead you to get into a state of anger which is uncontrollable. And there's some examples of anger escalating self-talk. So it's then considering what the best behaviour options are. Once you've got the anger into a position where it's no longer an emotional hijack, you can then start to work out what works best for you. And what you'd have seen from the video was a very nice example where someone physically hadn't got the anger under control, but behaviourally had chosen to do something different, and therefore wasn't expressing the same degree of frustration that you saw prior to the intervention. So had learned behavioural techniques to actually not display emotions and the emotion of anger, which was beneficial to those around him. Delaying action, trying to reprogram your thoughts so that you don't have to explode in a way that typically is unhelpful in most social situations. And step five: if you have managed to anticipate the anger, you have managed to keep it under control, you need to congratulate yourself. What you have to remember is that skills require practice. These are habits people get themselves into. So people get themselves angry because it's a habit they've got themselves into when they've met a source of frustration. And what they have to then teach themselves is to choose an alternative option to getting angry.
If we have a look at the coping literature, specifically related to coping interventions, there's a wide array of different approaches to coping interventions, as in the specific interventions that are utilised. However, they have a common format, and the format that's been identified by Baker is providing a rationale for the programme as a starting point, modelling or demonstrating the procedure or the coping intervention, whatever that may be, for example time management, having the individual rehearse or practice the skills that have been modelled or demonstrated, and then finally motivating the participant to transfer learning via self-directed activities, and that's transferring it across different situations. So for example, with our student athletes, it's applying them not only in an academic context, but in a sporting context, social, and possibly a work context as well. And it's looking at strategies for maintaining adherence to the new coping behaviours. Because ultimately, these coping interventions are intended to either prevent them from experiencing stress or lessening the effects of a stressor. So if we look a little further at the coping interventions that have emerged in the coping literature, appraisal is a key aspect of the coping process. We've talked earlier about primary and secondary appraisal. So that's got to be central to any coping intervention. And that's why you see any coping intervention has a cognitive component that is usually incorporated within that. So it's looking at reappraising stressful encounters and developing an alternative interpretation of those. Again, we've already talked about Lazarus and Folkman's work and the transactional model of stress with the primary and secondary appraisal, and so many of the coping interventions that have been developed to date have been built around this particular model. And that is looking at, firstly, that appraisal process. What does this mean for me? But it's also trying to take into account the personal and situational factors that an individual is faced with, and this in itself is why you see considerable variation in coping interventions that exist, because you must take into account the kind of stressors that an individual may encounter and their various personal factors, such as their age or their gender, as an example. So we've established that the process of many coping interventions are very similar, and this can be applied to emotional intelligence interventions. So for the purpose of this workshop, we're going to take a three-stage approach to devising and implementing an intervention. Stage one is the preparation for change. Now this can include aspects such as providing a rationale for change in emotional intelligence or coping behaviours, assessing current behaviours, both coping and emotional intelligence, so looking at self-awareness, regulation of emotions and so on and so forth, and then working with the individual to identify and agree areas that could or possibly should be targeted for change. Stage two is the training stage, and this is where we bring in the modelling or demonstrating the procedures or the skills that you're going to be working through, and then having the participants or the individuals rehearse or practice these skills. And then finally, in stage three, it's looking at the transfer and maintenance. So again, this is the transfer of these skills across different domains, so education, sport, so on, and motivating the individual to maintain these new behaviours long term. So what you're going to be asked to do is to take your student through stage one of the coping and EI intervention. So you'll be looking at their scores on the brief cope and the emotional intelligence scale. We'd like you to discuss these scores with your student, use prompts and probes, to what extent do they agree with the results of the questionnaires, what explanations do they have for the findings, which areas do they perceive as in need of development. And then select one of the coping packs that are on offer and work through these with your student. We'll then come back, having had some time to work through the packs, and we'll review them in terms of their strengths and their limitations and what the issues are for their continued implementation and generalisation. Okay, so as we've worked through the coping and emotional intelligence interventions, what's hopefully been demonstrated is that there is overlap and interrelationships between coping and emotional intelligence. The literature to date is starting to show, it's starting to appreciate this relationship, and it's identified the fact that emotional intelligence is influential not only over the selection but also the implementation of coping strategies. As an example, research indicates that higher emotional intelligence is linked with adaptive coping, whereas low emotional intelligence is linked to poor or maladaptive coping. It's been suggested that those individuals with higher emotional intelligence cope more successfully because they accurately perceive and appraise their emotional states. And because of this, they know how and when to express feelings and have effective strategies for regulating their mood states. Now, Lazarus once said that where there's stress, there's emotions. And it's generally acknowledged that in order to manage a situation, that the emotions have to be controlled and regulated appropriately. So you see the link here now between the coping and the emotional intelligence, and actually a lot of coping strategies are classified. The two early classifications of coping strategies were problem-focused and emotion-focused coping. So again, you see the importance of emotional intelligence for the coping process.
So the future of emotional intelligence and coping amongst student athletes, and there is a considerable amount of work that can be done, and the answering this issue is very, very complicated in terms of where it can start and where it can stop. So we're only going to make a few suggestions. Certainly, the notion that emotional intelligence and coping process should be integrated into the curriculum, in that teaching students to manage their emotions, how their emotions affects others, how they can cope with their own emotions, how they can cope with difficult situations and cope with potential stressors, is something which would be highly useful for students in terms of developing life skills, in terms of their sport performance, in terms of employable skills. Lecturers would be very useful at developing these skills as well, in that how they can then look to develop the skills of their students and also develop their own skills in this sense. Sport and exercise psychologists will, as we suggested earlier, that emotional intelligence and coping will certainly link to sports performance, and emotional intelligence sports psychologists would be desirable, because they can then be able to read the emotional states of their clients and also be aware of how the emotional states which they're in affect the affect those around them. And when we look to UK Sport and the EIS, who have lifestyle performance consultants who help athletes manage some of the lifestyle factors which are surrounding being a developing or actual high performance athlete, their ability to read the emotional states of others is highly useful. Their ability to encourage athletes to take adaptive coping strategies so that athletes learn to be able to cope far better for themselves seems a worthwhile area which to pursue. In terms of some of the research, well, it certainly needs to be evidence-based. The amount of research in emotional intelligence and coping in sport is relatively minimal, and it is a massive area for someone to expand. And we alluded to some of these research that we've been doing, but the emotional intelligence and coping will link to a whole variety of different areas of sport psychology, of performance, of health. And therefore, the choice of variables available is seemingly endless.
How many psychologists does it take to change a light bulb?
Don't know.
The light bulb must want to change.